Reformed civil code and one nation, one poll are the two big ideas bouncing out of the BJP's manifesto, which was released earlier this morning at the BJP headquarters. The Prime Minister and his government have promised to continue the war against corruption and have also promised health cover for those above the age of 70. Let me take you through some of the key promises made by the Prime Minister during the manifesto release. And as I said, during the course of the day, some of the senior ministers in the Modi government will be joining us to talk about the BJP's manifesto. And we'll try and give you a sense going across sectors of what to expect over the next 5 years if the government does get voted back to power. Here's the Prime Minister first.
Bhajpa sarkar ne garibon ko 4 करोड़ पक्के घर बनाकर दिए हैं। अब जो अतिरिक्त जानकारियां राज्य सरकारों से मिल रही हैं, क्योंकि परिवारों के विस्तार होते हैं, एक घर से दो घर बन जाते हैं और खुद नया घर बनाने की शक्यता संभावना नहीं होती है, तो उन परिवारों की भी चिंता करते हुए हम 3 करोड़ और घर बनाने का संकल्प लेकर के आगे बढ़ेंगे। मोदी की गारंटी है कि जन औषधि केंद्रों पर 80% डिस्काउंट के साथ सस्ती दवाएं मिलती रहेगी। इतना ही नहीं, इन दवाइयों के जन औषधि के केंद्रों का हम विस्तार भी करेंगे। मोदी की गारंटी है कि आयुष्मान भारत के तहत 5 लाख रुपए तक का मुफ्त इलाज मिलता रहेगा। मोदी की गारंटी के इसी क्रम में भाजपा ने एक बहुत बड़ा निर्णय लिया है। ये निर्णय 70 वर्ष की आयु से ऊपर के सभी बुजुर्गों से जुड़ा है। आज जो बुजुर्ग हैं उनकी बहुत बड़ी चिंता होती है कि बीमारी की स्थिति में इलाज का खर्च कैसे आएगी, और ये मध्यम वर्ग परिवार को ज्यादा होती है। अब भाजपा ने संकल्प लिया है कि 70 वर्ष की आयु से ऊपर के हर बुजुर्ग को आयुष्मान योजना के दायरे में लाया जाएगा। भारत आज विमेन लेड डेवलपमेंट में दुनिया को दिशा दिखा रहा है। पिछले 10 वर्ष नारी गरिमा, नारी को नए अवसरों को समर्पित रहे हैं। आने वाले 5 वर्ष नारी शक्ति की नई भागीदारी के होंगे। बीते 10 वर्ष में 10 करोड़ महिलाएं स्वयं सहायता समूह से जुड़ी है। 10 करोड़ बहनों के सहायता समूहों को अब हम आईटी, शिक्षा, स्वास्थ्य, रिटेल और टूरिज्म जैसी सेवाओं के लिए, जैसे होम स्टे वगैरह होता है, हम उनको ट्रेनिंग देंगे। अभी तक 1 करोड़ लखपति दीदियां बन चुकी हैं। अब मोदी ने 3 करोड़ बहनों को लखपति दीदी बनाने की गारंटी दी है। ये संकल्प पत्र विकसित भारत के 4 मजबूत स्तंभ, युवा शक्ति, नारी शक्ति, गरीब, किसान, इन सभी को सशक्त करता है। हमारा फोकस डिग्निटी ऑफ लाइफ उस पर है। हमारा फोकस क्वालिटी ऑफ लाइफ उस पर है। हमारा फोकस निवेश से नौकरी, निवेश से नौकरी पर भी है। इस संकल्प पत्र में क्वांटिटी ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज और क्वालिटी ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज दोनों पर बहुत जोर दिया गया है। एक तरफ हमने कई सारे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर निर्माण से बड़ी संख्या में रोजगार बनाने की बात की है, दूसरी तरफ हम स्टार्टअप और ग्लोबल सेंटर्स को बढ़ावा देकर हाई वैल्यू सर्विसेज पर भी ध्यान देने जा रहे हैं।
द बीजेपी मैनिफेस्टो इज ऑल्सो बीइंग ट्रैक्ड वेरी क्लोजली बिकॉज इट कैन पोटेंशियली गिव इंडिकेशंस ऑफ व्हाट viewers and voters can expect if the BJP does come to power. The Prime Minister asserting again and again that whatever is in the manifesto will indeed drive his government's agenda. And given that the BJP currently is in pole position to form the government, it's worth diving into some of the minutiae and the detailing of the BJP manifesto to have a clearer sense of what the next 5 years could potentially look like. Joining us on this broadcast is Rahul Verma, fellow at the Center for Policy Research. We've got Professor Badri Narayan joining us. Rajat Sethi is a well-known political commentator. And we've got Rashid Kidwai, author, political analyst, who has a very deep understanding of Indian politics, especially the Congress Party. I want to go across Rahul Verma first. From a bipartisan perspective, from a non-partisan perspective, Rahul Verma, what's your sense of the big ideas that you think the BJP is trying to communicate through the manifesto that's been released this morning?
Thank you, Rahul. I think there are a couple of points that are very clear. One, on the ideological front, BJP will continue to make some strides, and we've seen that they have mentioned about uniform civil code. They're going to continue some programs such as One Nation, One Election, for which the government appointed a committee under the former president, Ramnath Kovind. And it seems that if the parties voted to power next time, they're going to move ahead with this kind of plan. Third, I think the push on welfareism continues to be there. Prime Minister saying that we'll continue with a free ration scheme for another 5 years, and then talking about the four pillars where four groups on which the party or the government is going to focus: the poor, the youth, the farmer, and the women. And I think from electoral constituency viewpoint, the emphasis on women seems to be very interesting. What BJP seems to have done under Mr. Modi in last 5 years and now is continue pushing to get more and more women voters.
I want to go across to Aishwarya Paliwal. She's at the BJP headquarters at the moment, and with her is BJP's candidate from Delhi in the Lok Sabha elections, Bansuri Swaraj. Aishwarya, take it away.
Well, Rahul, you know, we have Bansuri Swaraj with her contesting from the New Delhi Lok Sabha constituency. Bansuri ji, we have seen how Prime Minister has covered all the bases. You know, he's spoken about all the sectors, spoken about people who are 70 plus, spoken about women. Do you believe, as a woman, the next 5 years will see the women of the country marching forward?
The next 5 years are going to be years of unprecedented growth and development for this nation. And I'm very grateful to the Honorable Prime Minister for actually bringing a manifesto for a Vikasit Bharat. This is a manifesto that has been developed in a very democratic way. There were suggestions which were called for. And so this is a manifesto which is reflective of the aspirations of India. It actually shows the expectations of India. And it is definitely reflective of Bharat becoming as a Vishwaguru.
Do you believe Char So Par is a motto that the BJP will now be able to achieve?
It is not a motto. It's a pledge. Ab ki baar Char So Par, phir ek baar Modi Sarkar. नारा नहीं है, संकल्प है, और संकल्प को सिद्धि तक लेके जाएगी भारत की जनता.
So this was Bansuri Swaraj, Rahul, very clearly now saying after the manifesto, this is a promise that they have made to the people, and this promise will now be fulfilled by the Bharatiya Janata Party. Rahul.
Thanks, Aishwarya. We'll come back to you for more in just a while. I want to go across at this moment to Rajat Sethi, because one thing that seems very interesting is given the push that we've seen over the past few weeks on Tamil Nadu, Rajat, the fact that you've got these cultural centers being set up, the fact that a party which was largely seen as being a party which put Hindi first, talking about taking Tamil, the Prime Minister called it the oldest language, wanting to take it abroad and expand its scope internationally. It really seems as if at every available opportunity, the BJP doubling down on its outreach in Tamil Nadu.
That's right, Rahul. Just yesterday, Home Minister Amit Shah was in Tamil Nadu, and to the public in Kanyakumari, he promised that within 3 years, he will learn Tamil language and come back and speak in Tamil to the people of Tamil Nadu. So I think there is a concerted approach, and more so, I think what BJP is trying to attempt is, for past three decades, BJP's manifestos hinged upon the core ideas of removal of 370, Ram Temple, etc. Most of these promises, the bulwark of BJP's manifesto has been actually satisfied and finished and completed. They want to take next big bold steps towards, its core ideology of nation first, party second. And I think they were looking for more core ideas to drive that momentum forward. One of the core building blocks is, how do you connect various parts of the country which were looked at from the Congress party ideologically as disparate sum of the parts? BJP has a very different perspective ideologically on this. They strongly believe that India is one and it should be seen in one spirit. And in order to meet those objectives, intermingling of language streams from across the part of the country is pivotal. So I see this part that was mentioned in the BJP's manifesto part of the larger project of the BJP to connect various parts into one emotional being.
Given the fact that Article 370 has been done away with, the Ram Temple has been built, the Uniform Civil Code left, but there is a certain sense of inevitability about what's coming. Does it then make it tougher for the BJP to get its base all charged up? You've got 10 years of being in power. People have seen what the government has done. And you spoke of the key ideological pillars of the BJP. Most of them have actually been accomplished. Does that then make it that much tougher for the crafters of the manifesto?
That is right. I think in one of your shows, Rahul, I had mentioned that BJP has actually completed some of its core agenda items. Like, what do you promise now to at least keep your base charged up? I think BJP here, since it was confident, it made development and welfare as its pivotal offerings to the public, and has the confidence that, it can actually ensure that the continuity is provided. Most of the schemes, by the way, that were highlighted are largely seen as a continuum of Modi 1 and Modi 2 and going into Modi 3. So I think BJP is still looking for those agenda items which can bind their base together or charge them up. Fortunately or unfortunately, this Sankalpa Patra doesn't have those elements.
And given the number of freebies, Rashid Kidwai, promised by the Congress, the BJP largely has stayed away from there. So there is no great sense of desperation. Sometimes when we see when the party may fear that they're on a sticky wicket, some things that the Prime Minister may not be comfortable with, like farm loan waivers, are accepted and agreed upon, but typically there is no such promise. So the BJP seems to be making this manifesto from a position of stability and strength. How do you compare what we've seen from the Congress and what we're seeing from the BJP, Rashid Kidwai?
So Rahul, I think the two political parties are in a very different frame of mind and in kind of, position in electoral politics. So therefore, the BJP is work in progress. So they are not in a position to make the kind of promises that Congress is making, like, making women Lakhpati and all kind of guarantees, etc. For Mr. Modi and BJP, it's work in progress. This manifesto, doesn't account for what has not been done. For instance, last manifesto also, the BJP had said that farmers' income would be doubled. Is there any sign of it? What about jobs? I mean, the CSDS survey is showing that job and unemployment price rise, these are the major issues, so they have not been addressed. So I think it's a very tall order. The two promises that Rahul Verma was saying about UCC, that all and one nation one polls, it all depends upon the kind of mandate whether the BJP will be able to bring about drastic changes in the constitution, and for that they require 350 370 figure. So this is the thing. I think it's high on intent but low on, as we say, on substance, because the BJP is 10 years. If you have not been fulfilled, if you're feeding 80 crore people, free with free ration, this is actually a Congress leave from the UPA and the Congress legacy. And this shows that the BJP is thrust on the social left part of it.
Professor Badri Narayan, from your lens, what stands out to you most when you read and hear what the BJP has to say about its manifesto for the next 5 years?
Rahul, actually, what I see that the entire election is on the election of the new image, and this is around PM Modi. Modi image is the central in this election. This election is not the election of narrative, this election of the image. And that's why you have seen in this Sankalp Patra, there is Modi ki guarantee. The entire election is organized on Modi ki guarantee. Modi ki guarantee means the trust which Modi has cultivated in public. BJP wants to cultivate, wants to use that trust in giving message to the people. Second thing is, which I used to say, this manifesto or Sankalp Patra is the Sankalp Patra in which they want to disseminate the hope, politics of hope. So hope is a mobilizing factor in this election. So BJP 2047, Viksit Bharat, we will give this and that. These are entire or hope. The hope narrative is the central in this Ghoshna Patra or in Sankalp Patra. And this hope narrative, the base is beneficiary. Beneficiary of different kinds. Beneficiary of four Garib, Yuva, Mahila, and all this four. And this beneficiary in substantial term, and Viksit Bharat and the big ideology in the form of abstract narrative, which this Sankalp Patra wants to concretize. So in that way, this Sankalp Patra reflect the big politics of the BJP with the micro management of the communities, their aspirations, their desires, and their hope. So this is a very ideal example of going politics of the hope.
Okay. Rajat Sethi, when the Prime Minister said at the India Today conclave, and I think he's kind of reiterating that subsequently, main to 2047 ki taiyari kar raha hu. What specifically do you think he's meaning? Does he mean that he's preparing India for 2047, or does he see himself as being in the fray at that time?
No, see, if you want to unwrap, there is an economic logic to it. What happens in 2047, the kind of foundations that you laid today are going to really impact what happens then. So for 2047, you can't begin a preparation in 2040. So I think he's clear that I'm laying foundations to see India as a developed nation, which means a per capita income of $20,000 approximately. And in that roadmap, you basically have two business cycles. And within those two business cycles, one business cycle is typically, 10, 12 years, 15 years max. And within those business cycles, you have to perform. And if you have to achieve that target of being a developed country, from here onwards till 2047, you need to grow at a breakneck speed of 8% year over year without even a single glitch. No democracy has actually gone through that. And that is a very tall ask, and we can't be sort of digressed at all in that journey. So I think
Rahul Verma, does this look achievable? I mean, as an Indian, it sounds fantastic if it can be achieved. $20,000 per capita income, that means each Indian has that as his basic income as an average by 2047. Does it look predictable? Because some of these promises we've heard before, doubling farm income by 2022, etc., it never panned out like that. Even the $5 trillion economy never really panned out. It's good to aspire to. At this moment, does it look achievable to you?
You rightly said, as an Indian, I would be happy if we reach there or even strive to reach there. But given where we are, and the kind of base we have and the infrastructure we have, I'm much more worried about India getting lost in a low income equilibrium trap. Forget about middle income, becoming a middle income country and going there. So hopes and aspirations are fine and we should have that. But I think the building blocks to be able to achieve those hopes and aspirations seem to be missing. We have the problem of unemployment, but we are not, I don't think any government can generate a large amount of employment given the kind of crisis global economy is facing. But the bigger challenge is the kind of investment that should be happening in our education, in our health, in our human capital. That doesn't seem to be happening. And so, we have been here before. In the 1990s, we thought we are going to do well. Again, in the late 2000s, we thought we are going to do well. There is again a window of opportunity open. I hope India takes up this opportunity, though the signs are not really good.
Rashid Kidwai, is there at all a plan for the India Alliance to have some kind of a joint agreement on what their potential manifesto could be, at least from the BJP? We've seen what to expect. We've seen the Congress's own manifesto. We've seen the DMK's own manifesto. So we're seeing different parties come up with their thinking. Will there at all be a common thinking that will be unveiled at some time?
No, Rahul, I think it's too late, and that's a very jarring note. I think the India Alliance should have come up with a comprehensive India Alliance manifesto, because the Congress is not in a driver's seat. It's just contesting 300-odd seats, and so it's very unlikely that the Congress would get a mandate on its own. So therefore, I think that's an opportunity that's missed. The Congress manifesto has tried to accommodate a lot of things like, Aam Aadmi concerns in the sense of having some kind of check on Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, and several other things are there which would appeal the other India Alliance constituents. But this is a case of a lost opportunity.
Speaking of the Congress, Supriya Srinath of the Congress party is addressing a press conference at this moment where the Congress is talking about its response to the BJP's manifesto. So we will go across to Supriya Srinath in a moment and also listen to what Mallikarjun Kharge has to say about this manifesto. So first here, Congress spokesperson Supriya Srinath reacting to the BJP manifesto.
को दिल्ली आने ना देने के लिए आपने सड़कें खुदवा दी, कीले गड़वा दी, आंसू गैस के गोले उन पर छुड़वा दिए, उनको आतंकी नक्सलवादी ना जाने क्या क्या कह दिया, लेकिन एमएसपी के कानून की बात मैनिफेस्टो में नहीं है। ये किसान के बारे में इसलिए बात करना चाहती हूं क्योंकि हमने अपने मैनिफेस्टो में डंके की चोट पर कहा है हमारी सरकार बनेगी, हम एमएसपी की लीगल गारंटी देंगे, एमएसपी का पूरा कानून बनाएंगे, कर्जा माफी करेंगे और खेती को जीएसटी से मुक्त करेंगे। मोदी जी के मैनिफेस्टो में ऐसी कोई बात नहीं है। एमएसपी के कानून का जिसका उन्होंने वादा किया था उसका भी जिक्र नहीं है। ऐसा क्यों है? क्यों इतनी खोट है नीति और नियत में? महिलाओं की बात करते हैं, युवाओं की बात करी, किसानों की करी, महिलाओं की करते हैं, कहते हैं महिलाओं को लखपति दीदी बना रहे हैं। कहां है ये लखपति दीदियां जिन महिलाओं को आटे दही पर जीएसटी देना पड़ रहा है, जिनको खाने का इन्फ्लेशन 8.5% जूझना पड़ रहा है, जिनकी कमर तोड़ रहे हैं आप महंगाई से, कहां है उनके लिए कोई राहत? कहां है महिलाओं के लिए बात? हम क्या कहते हैं? हम कहते हैं गरीब महिलाओं को हम 1,00,000 रुपए सालाना देंगे और साथ साथ नई सरकारी नौकरियों में 50% आरक्षण देश की आधी आबादी को देंगे। कहां है वो रिप्रेजेंटेशन? क्या आप दोयम दर्जा क्यों मानते हैं एक औरत को? आप जिक्र कर रहे हैं 33% आरक्षण का जो 2034 से पहले लागू नहीं होगा पार्लियामेंट में, लेकिन देश की एक आम नारी के लिए, एक आम महिला के लिए, एक आम लड़की के लिए जिसकी आंखों में सपने हैं भविष्य के, उसके लिए आपके मैनिफेस्टो में कुछ नहीं है। बहुत सर्च किया मैंने जॉब्स के बारे में, सर्च किया, मुझे तो कुछ नहीं दिखा। इसका जवाब कौन देगा? मैं उसके बाद बात करना चाहती हूं, इन्होंने बात की कि आतंकवाद खत्म हो गया है, शांति बहाल हो गई है। ये मेरे आंकड़े नहीं है, ये भारत सरकार के आंकड़े जो आपके सामने रख रही हूं। 2014 से 24 के बीच में जम्मू कश्मीर मात्र में 3,950 लोगों की आतंकी मुठभेड़ों में हत्या हुई है, जिसमें सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस भी हैं और सिविलियंस भी हैं। ये 3,950 लोग आपको भारत के नागरिक नहीं दिखते हैं? ये आतंकी हमलों का कोई मतलब ही नहीं है। आज की तारीख में जम्मू कश्मीर में आतंकी हमले में, आतंकी मुठभेड़ में अगर सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस, सिक्योरिटी और सैन्य बल के लोग शहीद हो जाते हैं तो मोदी जी उनके लिए ना एक शब्द श्रद्धांजलि का बोलते हैं, ना उनके परिवार को एक शब्द संवेदना का देते हैं। तो आपको क्या लगता है आंख मूंद ली तो ये जगत बना ही नहीं? 3,950 किलिंग्स और सैन्य बलों की शहादत जम्मू कश्मीर में पिछले 10 सालों में, आपके चेहरे पर एक बहुत काला धब्बा है, आंख मूंदने से काम नहीं चलेगा। यहां पर इधर उधर की बात की गई तो मैं दो बातें जरूर कहना चाहती हूं। मोदी जी के मैनिफेस्टो में मणिपुर का जिक्र नहीं है। मां से बड़ी बड़ी बातें करते हैं, मां से मणिपुर की बात करते हैं, मां से महंगाई की बात करते हैं, मां से महिला की बात करते, कोई खाका ही नहीं है। मणिपुर का जिक्र नहीं है, लद्दाख का जिक्र नहीं है, जहां पर सारे लोग आंदोलित होकर सड़कों पर हैं। मोदी जी के मैनिफेस्टो में चाइना कहां तक घुस आया और हम क्या करेंगे, कोई जिक्र नहीं है, क्योंकि कोई घुसा नहीं तो हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी नहीं कहा था। मोदी जी के मैनिफेस्टो में वो जो इनकम इनइक्वालिटी है इस देश में, जो गरीब और गरीब और अमीर होता जा रहा है, और जिसके लिए हमारे मैनिफेस्टो में पूरा खाका है, एक शब्द नहीं है। असलियत यह है कि राशन की बात करने वालों, 10 साल बाद जनता पूछ रही है रोजगार कहां है, और नहीं है इनके पास उसके लिए कोई प्लान। दो जगह जॉब्स मेंशन होती है उस देश में जहां पे 65% लोग 35 वर्ष की कम आयु के हैं। इतना युवा राष्ट्र, क्या प्रायोरिटीज है इनकी? मुझे लगता है मैं अपनी बात यहां समाप्त करूंगी। ना महंगाई का कोई सलूशन दिया है, ना नौकरी का कोई सलूशन दिया है, ना महिला सम्मान पे बात करी है, ना बात करी है किसान की, ना बात करी है युवा की, ना बात करी है चीन के अतिक्रमण की, और आंखें मूंद ली है जो शहादत हो रही है जम्मू कश्मीर में, और उसकी जगह बरगलाया जा रहा है। इस मैनिफेस्टो को देखकर लोग हाथ जोड़कर बोल रहे हैं, हो गया बस, बहुत हो गया प्रभु, 10 साल आपको मौका देकर देख लिया, जुमलों के अलावा हमें कुछ नहीं मिला, और अब आपको बदलकर एक ऐसी सरकार लाएंगे जो युवाओं के बारे में, महिलाओं के बारे में, किसानों के बारे में, उन लोगों के बारे में जो समाज के हाशिए पर है, श्रमिकों के बारे में, उनकी सोच, उनके न्याय की बात करती है।
धन्यवाद सुप्रिया जी। अब आपके सवाल, माइक दीजिएगा।
ये सब झूठे वायदे हैं, और हमेशा ऐसी चीजें झूठ बोलते 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 उन्होंने 2 इलेक्शन जीता, ये 3rd इलेक्शन में नहीं चलेगा, क्योंकि लोग एक बार विश्वास रखते हैं। फर्स्ट गारंटी हमने जो हिमाचल में दी वो निभाई, दूसरी गारंटी हम कर्नाटक में दी वो निभाई, तीसरी गारंटी का जो ये खोला वो तेलंगाना में दिया, वो कर दिए। हम तो वायदे पूरे करते हैं। अरे बाबा, तुमने जो वायदे किए थे वही अगर आप अनुष्ठान में नहीं लाए तो आगे क्या करने वाले हैं? लोगों का तो भरोसा उठ गया है।
14-19 ये जो माहौल था वो स्थिति रही नहीं हम लोगों की। अब जो वादे करते करते निभाए नहीं, काला धन लेके आएंगे, 15 लाख रुपए खाते में डाल देंगे, किसानों की आमदनी दुगनी कर देंगे, लोकपाल लेके आएंगे, क्या क्या नहीं कहा गया, वो तमाम वादे वादे रह गए हैं। अब वो क्रेडिबिलिटी वाली बात सही नहीं है बीजेपी की।